Esalen, as always, I get sort of tangled a little bit and conflicted, and then we start talking about it. It's the also true for the humanistic psychologists, also true, I gather, for the humanistic psychology meetings in Washington, to which I could not come, but people have been telling me about. It is one danger for humanistic psychology to become sort of anti-rational, anti-intellectual, or most especially sort of anti-science, in favor of feeling, experiencing, emoting, and so on. And it's a delicate knife edge. And for instance, here at Esalen, sometimes I feel myself to be on the right wing, and I'll get Mike Murphy into a corner and start propagandizing about the beauties of science and the rationality and intellect and so on. Although I must say that in the scientific circles, I usually get people in corner and talk about the beauties of experience and emotion. And the job really is to make a good structure, a good balance, a good relationship between them. Because I think experiencing, the regarding experience as sacred in itself is a very dangerous thing, I think. Knowledge makes sense out of experience. And experience without knowledge, even in terms of the experiencers, let's say the LSD kids, one thing that they're all familiar with is that the experiencing itself, if you take LSD and you don't know that you've taken it, or you don't know what's happening, or you don't know what to expect, then this can be a terribly anguished ordeal. It can be you're going crazy. The world starts blurring and so on, and it feels, I'm told that's what a schizophrenic feels like, is to watch reality just crumbling apart, falling apart. It's a very frightening thing. Well, what we've learned from the various experiments of the LSD people is that if you have a good guide, if you have a good circumstances, and I'd say if you have knowledge, if there's somebody to tell you, don't worry about that, that happens all the time, or that's a good thing, or in another 10 minutes it'll be something else, and so on, that even at that situation of pure experience, it's knowledge that makes it possible to assimilate and to have a good trip, as they say. And without the knowledge, you can't have a good trip. And even with the peak experience business, I now have a beautiful example, this dissertation that a student of mine did on peak experiences in natural childbirth, which should be published sooner or later, that here's an example of childbirth has generally been, through Western history anyway, a bad trip for a good purpose. People want babies and they'll endure any damn thing to get babies. Now we know that with knowledge, you can make a good trip out of it. That apparently childbirth can be a very beautiful experience, apparently as beautiful as anything in the whole blasted world. It can be just the greatest experience that there is with a good fortune, good training, good preparation, and so on. And it doesn't even have too much to do with anesthesia and with consciousness, because what this girl found out is that the natural childbirth training itself made everything wonderful, even if they couldn't stand the pain and took some anesthetic. It's not just consciousness alone at childbirth that makes the good trip and the peak experiences and the great ecstasies that can come to some women in this and to their husbands also, if they're permitted to come along with them. And this again is an example of knowledge making sense out of experience. Experiencing can be so frightening. And if you want the example, I know what I always think of is the descriptions of the subjective world of the schizophrenic, the man going mad. And it's so terrifying. The descriptions are of the sheerest, most profound anguish, panic, people dying in the middle of it, preferring to die, have to be protected from dying. So that to say that knowledge and ordering of experience is contradictory to experience is just crazy. It's just not so. It's knowledge that makes experience into a beautiful thing, and a good thing, and a useful thing, and a growing in terms of personal growth. So that I think it's very, very bad to put them against each other. Of course, on the other hand, what we're all familiar with is the experientially empty person, the stereotyped intellectual who just talks about experience and doesn't have it. I was talking at the breakfast table about Bertrand Russell's autobiography. Bertrand Russell's been puzzling me through all the years. He was a hero of mine when I was a youngster. And it was one of the learning experiences of my life that I came to, perhaps the age of 20 or so. Bertrand Russell and Reinhold Niebuhr had a debate in Cooper Union. And I'd never seen Bertrand Russell, and I came on my pilgrimage to Mecca. And I was very anti-clerical, and he was going to mop up the floor and so on, and this was the destruction. And then Reinhold Niebuhr stood Bertrand Russell on his head, made him look like a freshman. And I had to go staggering home to reorganize my life. Ever since then, Bertrand Russell has been so important for me. Somehow the love and the respect has only slowly, through decades, only slowly disappeared. Until in this last autobiography, which I read, where I could finally see what I think is clear, is that this is the empty intellectual, the non-peaker, the one who desperately is looking through the pane of glass into this promised land of feelings and emotions and love and so on. If you read that, you see the great, I think, a man incapable of love, because the cruelty to his women is just, it's just cruel to one wife after another. I don't know, half a dozen of them or so. And talking a great deal about feelings, and then showing not to have them. His relations with Whitehead, as spelled out in that book. Whitehead apparently was not only a great man and a great philosopher, but in my area I hear about it, also a wonderful person. Clearly the self-actualizing person. Also a lovable man. The students around there just adored him. And to see Bertrand Russell just being snide and snotty to Whitehead, in this well, that, if you want to, it just happens that's what I remember as an example of the empty intellectual desperately talking about compassion, talking about all sorts of things, making big theories about compassion. The word is in capital letters, and then being mean to his wife, you know, that kind of thing. Compassion for a human species, kick your kids in the teeth. You know, if a man kicks his kids in the teeth, then the talk is fake. It's empty. You know it is. Well, now in this book, the big book that I'd recommend, if you have the time for it and the will, the big manual for this entering into this structuring of science and experience, really putting them together. The big book is by Michael Polanyi. I think I mentioned that, The Personal Knowledge. That's one of the great books of the time, I believe. It's hard, but it's worth it. My book has the advantage of being small by comparison, also being more psychologically oriented, which Polanyi was a physical chemist and had his center in another place. I think the books supplement each other well.
What is the title?
Personal Knowledge by Polanyi. Polanyi. This is your problem too, is to try, if we cannot do without concepts, we cannot do without abstractions, we cannot do without words, because then you're just nuts, you're schizophrenic. Life is a chaos altogether. And it's the chaos is frightening for most people, not beautiful. That the since we need these abstractions and concepts and theories and words, that then the question is how to root them in experience. That is, how to make their roots go right into the stuff of human experience. And that, I think, is easy to do, if you want to do it. If you keep in mind that your abstraction is supposed to be blood-filled, not empty. Not like the, there's one German-type professor that I know that I've worked with and so on. He's a very famous man, everybody thinks he's wonderful. He talks also big words, you can almost see them in the Saul Steinberg, you know Saul? You know, those words that... And this man produces these beautiful words, big words, that Saul Steinberg would love to make cartoons about, you know. These sail off the surface of the earth. They have no contact with the earth at all. They are, once I remember in an exasperation, I talked about his helium-filled words. You know what I mean about this? Well, this is our job, and it is to put together abstraction and experience, to organize experience so that you can enjoy them and handle them and manipulate them, and so you're the boss rather than the frightened slave. Well, if you take that seriously, then a humanistic science, that is a science which regards itself in Polanyi's fashion as essentially the product of human beings, human people, it's a byproduct. Just as much as any other human institution, it's a byproduct of human nature. The scientists are human, as the title of one book was, of a predecessor of Polanyi, the forerunner. And furthermore, science comes out of human nature, and it is for human nature, that is, it's not a chess game, it's for the sake of human satisfactions, for the sake of human needs. And then if you want to talk about meta-science, where you're talking about the B-values and the transcendent experiences, then science is one of the beautiful ways to get peak experiences and to get mystic experiences. If you redefine science as the, let's say, the technique of increasing your enjoyment of mystery. That's not a bad phrase. That's as I was saying, the last chapter in this book of mine is the one that I enjoy most, because it reminds me of that came in great bursts of happiness and excitement and illumination and insight, and I was in kind of a perpetual fever for a while there. Originally, the title of it was that last chapter, Wonder, Science, and Wonder. That is the naive wonder and then science. And science doesn't kill wonder, it just makes it more enjoyable, more peaky, more mystical, more transcendent. And then we have this at the transhumanistic science, you would say science then is the one path to heaven, one path to emotion. And you then one theorem works out. It sounds paradoxical. The more you know, the more mystified you are. That is, if I could take knowledge at this level, not as a way of cutting out mystery and of solving problems, but of really enjoying, of really understanding how totally insoluble the problem is. And then of standing before it, you know, like a child before some big thing and letting your jaw drop open and your eyes bug out, and that's a very nice experience. Do you enjoy the experience of awe, of wonder, these trance-religious experiences? Then one of the very good ways of having such experiences is to become a scientist. A humanistic and transhumanistic scientist. And you can study some of the examples I have in my thing, were my own experiences of of studying in a histology course. I still remember that. You, if you can remember an experience for 40 years, you know that was a, some experience, of in a histology class in a medical school with a stink of formaldehyde and cadavers and so on, hardly a likely place, it would seem, yet it can be. The studying the structure of the kidney and getting more and more absorbed in it and more the wonder of it. The kidney is really an impossible organ. It's just impossible. And yet there it is before your eyes. And you, the more you study it, the more impossible it gets. How is this miracle conceivable, I'd say. And then you come back to it, and the more you know, and the more you know, and the more you know, and then one day it happened to me. As I looked through the microscope, I just went off the earth. And what was that? It was study, hard study. Microscopes, stinking formaldehyde, everything, had made it possible to have this very, very wonderful experience. Well, things stand on their head a little bit. Science is for the sake of increasing the sense of mystery. No, at the objectivistic level, science, everybody uses it and regards it as a... Well, we get horrified frequently by science. I know. Do you know that Masters and Johnson thing, the book on sex? Well, the first time I heard Masters and Johnson, they gave a report. I was horrified. These copulating machines, for instance, and of people copulating before a camera crew and with lights and so on, and then Masters saying, you know, gives us lectures about what happens then, and I said, hasn't it ever occurred to you? The one thing, the question of volunteer error, that was a term that I had invented, which he'd never heard about, where I had proven in the Kinsey experiment that Kinsey and I did an experiment together, which he refused to publish. So I finally had to publish it myself. In which I proved very well in an experiment that he and I had set up together, because we'd been arguing about who are the people who give sexual histories, who volunteer to give sexual histories. And well, I proved the point. These are not a general sample of the population. It's a general, no, it's a strong people who don't mind. Take your clothes off, to take their clothes off. These are stronger characters who are not shy, timid, and so on. It's called high dominance or high ego strength, and so on. But high ego strength people have a different kind of sexual life than shy people or quiet or retiring people. So that all of Kinsey's data are wrong. That is at least suspect. They're all exaggerated because Kinsey's book should be labeled The Sexual Life of High Dominance People. Not of sort of shy characters who have a different sexual life. So for Masters and Johnson, the same thing. Who in God's name is going to, what husband and wife will get on a table and start copulating for you and your cameras and so on? And he thinks of himself a very good scientist. You know, such factors are non-scientific. It's a very peculiar business, but they obviously something is missing from Kinsey and from Masters and Johnson and so on. The machinery, of course, is there, and I trust the reports about what happens to the vaginal wall and so on and so on. And I'm grateful for that information. They do. I was talking then as a scientist, but my gosh, there's a good example. Simone de Beauvoir, who's an awful, I think also a non-peaker, like Sartre, who's definitely an experientially empty person. that was a word man. Just words, helium-filled words, let's call it. stick, that's a good term there. And who has no roots in experience. That Simone de Beauvoir wrote a kind of an introduction to a sex book that somebody had written. And this was about sexual life of women. And did this marvelous boner that she pulled there. And they said, this book is very welcome. We know very, very little about women's sexual life. And then the male, of course, snickered. Do we know anything more about anything than about males, as I was pointing out? Males have been assiduously exploring this subject ever since in the cave. Every female has experiential knowledge, every male has spectator knowledge, and so on and so on. Is there anything in the world that we know more about than female sexual knowledge? And then she said, in a particular sense, of course, in the one particular sense, she was correct, that scientific knowledge we do have some scientific knowledge, but humanistic scientific knowledge we have very little about, very little. Transhumanistic scientific knowledge, practically zero. So that we have, you see how you can use the words differently there? And that science need not be a monster. Science can be a very beautiful thing. For my part, I love it. And I don't feel that love to be any contradiction to my love for art or babies or whatever. It's all a piece. It's all one and the same thing experientially. To me it is. And I warn you, I urge you, I'd like to be now the professor and to shake my fingers and so on. Don't fall into this trap of mistrusting science. It's a dangerous trap. Just because most scientists are non-peakers, don't fall into the trap, because science can be something very, very beautiful, very illuminating. It can be a path to heaven. It can be a path to ecstasy, to beauty.
Isn't the trouble with much of science, though, that it becomes, in the terms you use, functionally autonomous?
Yeah.
It sets up its own body, it sets up its own precepts, its own concepts, its own standards, and divorces itself from what its function actually is intended to be in person.
Well, this is the danger in any field of life, that we always, this is one of the existential problems for us, that is really the insoluble problem. Whatever we do, we want to do well. And you might say professionalizing it. And that can be for anything. For women, let's say, motherhood. And that too can be professionalized, and you can read all sorts of books and become an authority on motherhood, and meanwhile your children can go hungry. And so this is always a danger, it's always a possibility. And the people who give lectures about love are not necessarily good lovers. And the people who do researches with creativeness are not necessarily creative people. And there are paradoxes and contradictions there. But if you have possession of yourself, if you are your own man, if you write your own lines, then there is no danger from professionalism and from skill and from expertness. Because then you are the boss. You have never been carried away by this machine. And this is the... I would urge that even this science that I was talking about, this Masters and Johnsons kind of thing, which I might snicker at occasionally, yet I honestly respect it another level and use. And I meant what I said there, that while at first I was very shocked and I didn't know how to, conflicted, and I was there in this meeting with another... You know, Eric Erickson. Well, Eric and I were standing there. He was just shocked altogether, and he said, that man is crazy, he's schizophrenic, and somebody ought to do something about that. And I was a commenter on the paper, and I said, well, I'm going to do something about it, but you back me up, will you? he disappeared. And I was left on the platform to get clobbered by all the second-level scientists. Even though I accept that. See, the whole of sexological information, the kind of work that I did, the exploring with sexuality, was all done with words, with interviews. And there are many things that Masters and Johnson told us that was false. I mean, that he corrected my information. As a sexologist, I can say that I learned more from Masters and Johnson about the facts, the physiological, anatomical details, than I had ever known before, including the fact that he corrected some of our misconceptions about this and that and the other. So, okay, the knowledge of the machinery and so on, which is knowledge, and that can be respected. When I got up on the platform there and said there were four speakers in this symposium on new knowledge and sexual research and so on, and I mentioned, maybe a little timidly at that point, because I was pretty definitely not among friends, all of these four papers were, for instance, pre-Freudian, as if Freud had not yet been born. Another point was, I heard, diffidently I said, that I hear tell that sometimes love has something to do with sex. And then they pounced on me, and I got, one of the men called me an evil man. That was Frank Beach up at Berkeley, who's, again, who's a very good lifetime researcher with the sexual life of animals. You know, won thousands of experiments, the piling up of little details and so on. And he certainly has piled up enough details so it matters at the end of a lifetime. But he was the one who got purple in the face, and as I mentioned, dared to mention the word love in that very scientific, quote, scientific meeting, he got up and said in a great temper, face purple, turned around on a platform, you know, in front of a thousand people or so, psychologists, and went like that, "You are an evil man. Why do you want to destroy science?" Now, there is the confrontation. That's as blunt as you can make. This was published, by the way, and I said, look, this is very useful. Be sure that you don't get polite now and edit this out. I had urged that my words and Frank Beach's words be verbatim, just my response to this, and so on. And Frank lost his nerve. He edited that out. It's not in the book. There's a book called, published, Advances, Recent Advances in Sexual Research. But my words are there, and most of his words are there with that harpoon taken out. Okay, I think that covers what I wanted to say, that I would urge that here, especially in these surroundings, that we certainly respect the fact that American citizens generally are not experiential enough, and that we have that to learn. That to go back to the origins, to go back to first experiences, is certainly, I recommend it. But I can recommend that even for the sake of humanistic science. That's a way of making your concepts more meaningful, more rich, more blood-filled. Several people had brought up this thing. Now it's a real concept. For instance, I have letters from the humanistic psychology meeting. Several of you were there. I wasn't, unfortunately. And the letters are from what you might call the left wing and the right wing. Some people who felt it wasn't, that the discussion was too woolly, and even on the edge of anti-intellect. Knowledge is a danger, you know, that sort of thing. Knowledge because it cuts your experience. Or because the experience you can't put into words, which, by the way, is nonsense. You can't put it into words. and then other people felt there was too much talking in this thing. There was a mixture of both experiential workshops and a panel or two of people arguing about concepts, philosophy. And that's a real problem, is how to put these together. There it was, I think if you took a vote, you'd find 50% of the people there who said it wasn't intellectual enough, and the other 50% saying it was too intellectual, it wasn't experiential enough. Do you have any comments on that?
It must have been about Martin and Jonathan. I appreciate their findings and so, but I object that they draw their conclusions then. For example, they point out that for most, masturbation is more satisfactory than intimacy.
Yeah.
But that doesn't mean that this is the normal thing. That means that the average is below par.
It means that the people who report to Masters and Johnson maybe are a special set of the population.
So now they conclude that this is the thing to do, you know, and yeah. This is what I object. Yeah. I mean, if they find it fine, I'm grateful to know it, you know.
Yeah. Well, I must report to you that this is between us. It has to be ad hominem. My impression is that they're both nice people, especially Mrs. Johnson. As she, I think, gives the humanity to that pair. Masters is a very tough scientist, you know, there's cool, very capable, intelligent, and so on. But I think what psychopathologists might, a little on the schizzy side, there's a little detached from human beings. I think you'd have to be in order to do that kind of work. He's reasonable and decent and nice and so on. I mean, there's no villainy in this anyplace. I had wondered how he could possibly get anybody to volunteer for these things, and then I learned that it was Mrs. Johnson, who's a very nice woman, and who looks just... that she must have got the volunteers, and made, she must be, if any of you are in business, she must be the greatest salesman of all time. Yeah, there are... this was also true for Kinsey, who tried very hard to be what he thought scientific, and then wound up making all sorts of wild statements that any man in his right mind or woman in her right mind would know were false, just from private experience.
Then we asked him, how do you know the truth? And he said, well, by looking them in the eye. Then we get into metaphysics.
Yeah,
I can look in the eye too, and the truth, and only the scientists for them.
Well, we have new possibilities. If any of you are interested in science, there are these untilled fields, unworked gold mines, the young people especially looking for beautiful and satisfying careers, and so on, to work with the whole business of, at the humanistic level, of love and sex. You know, at the humanistic level, we know very little about sex. And to work at that level is just make a beautiful life, you know. You just feel so fruitful and so useful and so necessary and so needed and so... You can think of yourself then as being a kind of a cornucopia, you know, passing out blessings to mankind and so on. That's, wouldn't it be true? Because we, in terms of this usable, transmittable knowledge, we have so little of it.
There's one thing left in the air for me from yesterday morning, and that is you made a comment that kids entering college, well, the boys are in worse shape than the girls. And I don't think that's always been the case, and I wonder if you could make a comment upon the cultural changes that brought this about to some extent.
Well, mostly I conceive it to be the emancipation of women. It's possible in this society for women, in maybe in a few other places too, in the Scandinavian countries and so on, for the first time in all of human history, for women to actualize the self. You know, to become full human beings. It has never before been possible. Now this is making a great turmoil, as women changing from slaves and possessions and little girls and doll's house occupants and so on into people. Well, there's a big, my impression is that there's kind of a big dislocation going on, because men and all of our cultures are based upon this. Even the laws are based upon the assumption that women are nitwits and dolls and sexual objects, and not to be taken too seriously. To be enjoyed as one might enjoy dolls, and to be patted on the head and so on. Well, this is changing, and it's going to take some decades, I think, a generation or so, for the men to get to the point of enjoying fully human women and not to be afraid of, which they are. And I see signs of that. There are some. See, the sign, I think, will be when the majority of men will find in women, will find brains, intelligence, capacity, personality, strength to be erotically attractive. That's the test. When they find that, when they see a woman who her brains just whirling nicely, intelligent, wise, and so on, is then for the males to get an erection. Consider it. I mean it in the strict sense. That the fully developed woman, and I mean psychically, spiritually, not only bodily, that the fully grown, the fully human woman ought to be, for a fully human man, far more appealing, far more attractive, far more beautiful, far more exciting, erotic, sensuous, sensual, and so on and so on. Then we'll know that the culture has changed in this respect. Now, I already see this. There are, I don't know what the statistics are, but if you go looking for such men, they exist. My impression... You see, that's what all the young women ask. It takes longer. It seems to take longer for young men to come to that point. My impression is that there are young men of, let's say, around the age of 25 to 30 or so, who can develop to that point of finally lusting after a capable, able, good executive, good boss, good brainy, intelligent, talented, superior woman. They exist, but they're in short supply. That's very definite.
That's borne out in my practice, that women seem to have no place to go now but up, which is a wonderful evolution going on.
Yeah.
And the men apparently resist coming to the table to be down from the perch, from pedestal,
yeah,
giving up dominance, superiority,
yeah,
and greater freedom of action.
That's right.
And for them, equality looks like a loss.
Yeah.
And for those who make it, and occasionally one does make it, and that's a good answer, where are they? I watch an occasional one who makes it, and it's epitomized by one who told, in the middle of an interview, told me, my God, he said, I've discovered women.
Yeah.
Very attractive guy, stature, and general position, but certainly no problem about women in general, married and so on, you have the children. But for him, there was a whole new world that had opened up in seeing what happened when women had an opportunity,
yeah,
to really flower out as a,
yeah,
fully human being.
It's a little, you can make a comparison once I thought of this visual image. For a lioness, it's most fun to mate with a lion. And then I'd say, contrariwise, for a lion, it's better to have a lioness rather than a pussycat. It's just more fun. It'd just be more fun. But the point is, you have to be able to be a lioness. You mustn't be frightened by a lioness. You must learn to enjoy the lioness, which means that you yourself, if you're the man, must become a fully human man.
There's another angle to that. I didn't mean to interrupt, but that how many women realize this potential without feeling guilty about emasculating men?
Yes.
We hear of men.
Practically all of them. This is the standard problems for these women who... there's a quick therapy. This is one, since I keep looking for these therapeutic tricks all the time, that, you know, in 5 minutes, 10 minutes, and so on. It's give advice fast. I have no time. And that I have found that for women, even young women, that it sometimes is possible, very quickly, just to say in an authoritative fashion, you know, I'm the professor of psychology, and so on and so on. Don't worry anymore about that. This is a good development in women. You're growing well. You may have trouble finding yourself a good man, but certainly don't worry about yourself. This is, we call it self-actualization in women, and so on and so on. Then I'd warn them, don't fall into the trap of trying to look good. You know, don't camouflage yourself as a pussycat, because you might get a cat instead of a lion and find yourself stuck in a lifetime marriage with someone who's you just feel not respectful enough. But this is possible to say. I think my impression is this is so close to the surface and so unrepressed. This is so un-Freudian, that even this kind of 10-minute talk here, I think, can change. There are women in this room and men in this room who must have changed just in this 10 minutes and heave a sigh of relief or something of the sort. So that's it. Well, I won't worry about that. And then to take their fates in their own hands, as I've urged women, don't make a stupid marriage just for the sake of marriage. Don't be desperate about it. Wait and hope, and meanwhile, just you be sure to be authentically yourself. If you are authentically yourself, this is sending out signals. It's as if you had a sender, a radio sender. You're sending out signals in all directions, and maybe the right male will catch the signal. But if you're sending out the wrong signals, pussycat signals, then the lion that you're looking for, he'll hear them and he'll run away. He won't run. So that you may then, by your camouflage, and in order to attract, to be popular, you may offend the very person who could make give you a happy life. So this is this can be very quickly effective, I think. If you see it, once it's an insight, then you've seen it, and it never disappears.
You know, there's another aspect to the earlier question of why women are doing better in college, I think. And I think that the expectations in terms of the marketing and production orientation of our culture is much different for women than it is for men. Mm-hmm. And they have a much more latitude in academically and emotionally, I think, in college.
Yeah.
Well, I think that that there are expectations of men to produce and to provide a more marketable package than there are for women. I don't think the expectations are as great, culturally and socially. I don't feel that they're as great.
Career, for one.
Yeah, the career and the provider. And in economic terms, economic and productive terms.
Dr. Maslow, are you familiar with, you have at Stanford, developmental stages at the college level, and I read a paper of his, which I think went into the American College, and I haven't finished Self and Society yet, so I don't know whether it's in there, but he talks about authoritarianism as a characteristic of the college age, I presume, youth. I mean, it would seem more...
I don't know, I haven't read that.
Not yet. But anyway, within the last two or three years, he's done some thinking of this, upward levels of development stages, this being one of them at the college level. I think American College had something on in this. I think it was a chapter, a rough draft chapter, that later went into this that I read.
Yeah, well, I'll be reading that this year, I know, exploring that stuff. My own impression is that this is, you can say it in different ways, but young men, my impression is practically all of them, good ones, bad ones, insightful ones and blind ones and so on, that the nice ones, out of a sense of responsibility and so on, will say, well, I have to get into medical school, and we'll think about it. I must be prepared to earn a living, support a family, and so on and so on. And then we'll bow their heads to the winds that prevail as necessary. You want to get into medical school, you have to do certain things. And with girls, there's much more leeway. They don't have that sense of this absolute necessity, the whole culture and also from within, the pressure to become the professional person or the wage earner, you know, and so on.
Which is constricting, really, in terms of self-actualization. I think these extraneous pressures are constricting and encapsulating rather than...
Well, it can be, but it needn't be. It's possible, after all, see, I've said this 3-4 times now, it's possible if you are your own man. It's possible if you know what you're doing. To walk through... You can walk through the slaughterhouse without getting any blood on you. You can go. You can use the medical school. You can use the establishment. You can be dignified. Look, if people were dignified in the concentration camps, it's possible to be dignified under any circumstances whatsoever. Anything. On the point of death and slaughter, you can be. And you can use the situation, and you needn't bow your head. And if it makes a great difference if somebody presses you, you know, puts pressure on you, must have these required courses or something of the sort, at least you don't have to like it. That saves your dignity. You may have to go through it, you may be forced through it, maybe. And then if, with it, as I've said, I think yesterday we talked about this, if in that spirit, it doesn't destroy you and it doesn't hurt you. You shrug your shoulders and sometimes you get impatient, angry, irritated and so on. Sometimes you laugh at it. But in any case, it doesn't get to your core. It doesn't hurt you. So I don't think it's a tremendous danger to any person who is his own man or any person or own woman that... You can live among slobs. You don't have to get to be a slob. Or you can live among fools. That doesn't require you to be fool. And so you can walk through these educational situations and keep your own dignity. You are your own agent rather than acted upon. You're not helpless. If you bow your head to the winds, at least you don't have to like it. You don't have to identify with the aggressor. You can keep your own self to yourself, really, wherever you are. In principle, you can do that. Sometimes it's harder, sometimes. But in any case, for women, in that the women have, without the pressure of this kind that young men have, and that the young men are very conscious of, the young woman can say, well, I'm going to be a doctor. And there are so many outs for her. There are no outs for men. A man who goes to medical school and quits after 2 years is a failure. He's a failure for the rest of his life. That's a scar. He feels it. Everybody else feels it. What's the word? He freaked out. But the woman needn't. She's got alibis of all sorts. She can go off to this, that, and the other thing. She can, if necessary, as so many young women unfortunately do, confronted with a really tough situation, marry out of it. So there's a real difference there. The pressures, I think, are differential. Yeah?
But isn't he going to medical school for the wrong reason?
not the one I was thinking of. You know, being a physician can be a wonderful thing. It can be a very beautiful, very noble, very fine, very dignified. He doesn't have to join the AMA hierarchy, you know. You can fight the AMA and be a doctor. That's, as a matter of fact, that's one way of being a good doctor. You don't have to take on, as I said before, just because you oughtn't to be, there's no guilt by association here. You have to find out in the case of the individual person that maybe he wanted to be a doctor for the right reasons. And maybe he goes through it for exactly the right reasons. Maybe he keeps the... Maybe he's a doctor under the aspect of eternity, even though he may never speak about it, and so on. There's one... this young woman, I feel, is she did become a doctor. She stuck it out. This woman, I don't think she ever mentioned it to anyone else. I was talking with her about the desacralizing in the medical school kind of thing. And then she told me, apparently what she'd not mentioned to anyone ever before, that she couldn't help it. This was her internship, she was delivering babies for a time. Said each time, each baby that emerged, she got tears in her eyes and cold shivers and so on. But she hadn't mentioned that to anyone. This is not scientific, professional. Well, I trust this young woman. She can be my doctor anytime she wants. I just put myself into her hands with complete faith. She's a good doctor. I'm certain of it. Whereas most doctors are not, in that same sense, good doctors. But we mustn't tar them all with the same brush. As a matter of fact, in any field, and that includes, you know, artists, let's say, most artists are lousy. Just like most dentists or most streetcar conductors or most janitors or most anybody. The really good ones are always in short supply in any field. Good shoemakers.
Dr. Matto, when you were talking about these kids going through college and keeping their goals in mind and not being sullied by what they're coming in contact with, it seems to me you're confusing the means with the ends here. One of the ends of college, properly organized, properly administered, is to make these self-actualizing people. You're assuming now the youngster starts out and already has this great insight, this great knowledge, this great understanding, and that college is more or less an obstacle which he's going to successfully tread his way through. It seems to me that college should be the place where these youngsters who are in the process of learning, who want to come to this and get this in college, not that they have to fight through college as an obstacle,
yeah,
but that college is the means to this end.
Yeah.
Not that they already have the end and they're going through an obstacle.
Yeah.
And I think that this is the great thing that most people here are confused about, is how do you use college to get this end, not how do you go through college with the end already there and not having it blunted.
Yeah.
This is an orthodontic
experience. Yeah. Well, we spoke about that last night. I'd stick to my guns. I feel very optimistic about it. I think it is possible to get an education in college. I know that's an extreme statement for very far out. If you know what you're about. And also, if
how
you...
How about the ones who want to know what they're about and are looking for college to give them that? Yeah. They're the ones who aren't going to find it there.
Well, there are better colleges and worse colleges from the point of view that we've been discussing. The more conscious we all are of this and the more conscious we can make other people, the more open the discussion and so on, the better things are going to be. The critique of the colleges goes on perpetually. They are improving. A good education, I think, is more possible today than it was 40 years ago. things do move, even though they move, let's say, at the pace of the glacier. Well, this is our job.
It seems to me the emphasis should be on how do you counsel kids to get what they want out of college and what they should get out of college, rather than to say, well, you know what your goal is, and avoid this and avoid this, and keep the right frame of mind. I think it's more important to tell these kids, now, this is what you must be looking for, and this is what you must be striving for.
Yeah.
That sort of counseling I don't think is available.
It is. See, there's this kind of a self-selection, of course, but in any, you'll find in any place, even in the lousiest situation, you'll find, let's say, in a college that we would consider to be the very, very bad college. Okay, there are two or three underground characters in the faculty who love intellect and so on. There are 1,000 students, let's say, and most of them don't amount to much from the point of view we've been discussing, but there are always two or three or four of them who, and then these people tend to find each other and to love each other, and they make a little oasis in the middle of the desert. So, it happens. I know this happened to me, that when I went to impersonal schools, where I just lost in the rush for a time, but finally went to the University of Wisconsin, which then was a small school. It was there were very few students and so on, and I showed up as a junior, I guess it was, an undergraduate, and registered in the courses, and most of the students were just, it was run by fraternities and sororities, and they were all jockeying for social position. Football, it was a football school. And here, to the pleasure and amazement and delight of my professors, here turned up somebody who knew how to read. Well, what happened with my, I had five professors who just seized upon me as if I were a long-lost son. And they I think they loved me. I think they just, one professor is still a friend whom we're going to visit so many years after it. He was my English professor, and he fed us later on during the Depression, you know, and we gave us good food. One of my professors, Bill Sheldon, the psychologist will know, William H. Sheldon, actually went and taught me. He went buying clothes with me and so on, and taught me about how you buy clothes, and took care of me and fed me. My philosophy professor, we still have correspondence. So many years later, he invited me to his home, and they were delighted with me, and of course I just flourished like a flower under this this treatment. This happened, and there are always some students, some professors. There always have been. I think the number is growing greater now. I think that instead of this kind of picture, there are now many schools where there are real communities of what we might call, in our sense here, intellectuals of the, you know, of the human kind. You just have to seek them out. There are some tragedies about it, because, for instance, if you're a very shy student and you go to Berkeley, once when I was in business here in San Francisco, the secretary that we had was a Nisei girl, generally shy. She'd been at Berkeley for 4 years and had never spoken to a professor face-to-face, nor had a professor ever spoken to her. 4 full years of school. Well, Berkeley paid for it eventually. That kind of thing. So she got lost. But the ones who are a little tougher and a little more forward and fight their way in, just like the puppies, you know, at the breasts of the mother. You've watched some, the little runt puppy dies. He can't fight his way to the nipple. And to some extent this exists. But then there are books and counseling services. So things, by comparison with the situation in which I was in, where I felt through all these years of college that I was a freak and nobody told me anything else, and that I led a whole inner secret life, reading books secretly, you know, because it was a peculiar, as if it were perversion of some sort. Writing things to myself and feeling absolutely out of the world altogether, just not really in it, complete outsider, until I came to that situation there. It's far better now, far better.